Hello everybody, this is a lecture of architectural heritage, and today we are going to talk about the place of Indian architecture in world architecture. Just to clarify it in the very beginning, we are not going to worry about the various traditions of world architecture and the details there. We're just going to focus on the various influences that were there on Indian architecture from various traditions of architecture across the globe. Historically, we are going to look at historically how various phases of Indian architecture had influences from various traditions of the world architecture. Before going into those details, we'll just briefly look at how the world architecture has been classified by scholars of architecture. And we broadly divide the world architecture into three types or three categories: ancient architecture, medieval architecture, and Renaissance architecture. I think the labels are clear enough themselves. In ancient architecture, we look at Egyptian, Greek, and Roman architecture. In medieval architecture, we look at Christian architecture, Byzantine art, Romanesque art, and Gothic art. And in Renaissance architecture, we obviously look at the the attempt at reviving the ancient classical architecture. So this is the brief division in of world architecture. In ancient period, we have primarily the Egyptian model. Egyptian models include tombs, focus of architecture on the construction of tombs and temples. And in Greek architecture, we have a strong trabeate element visible in the building style of the Greeks. In Roman architecture, we have the influence of arches are there. Arcuate style has been adopted in Roman architecture, and also there is a use of marble very widely in the Roman style of building construction activity. Apart from that, in medieval art, there was a focus on the construction of churches. We know in the context of world history, this particular medieval period of world history has been classified as a dark age, a middle age in which there was a great dominance of religious zeal and religious spirit. And in that context, there was this domination of the church, and majorly the architectural activity of this period is also focused on the construction of various types or various architecturally different styles of churches. Right, we're not going to go into those details. We just need to know that there were early Christian art of longitudinal churches that were there, which had strong Roman influences. Then we had Byzantine art, with which came the use of pendentives in order to construct domes over square rooms or square or rectangular chambers. Then we have Romanesque art around 11th to 12th century AD in Europe, which had influences of Roman and Byzantine elements. And we have then the Gothic art in the 12th and the 13th centuries of world history or European history, which developed in France. The Gothic art developed in France, and usually in the Renaissance context, the term Gothic art was used in a negative or in a derogatory manner, because these were the architectural activities or architectural trends of the so-called Middle Ages or Dark Ages, which Renaissance claims to have overcome, or with the coming of Renaissance, with the coming of Enlightenment, that dark time ended and a new era of scientific and rational spirit had emerged in the European context. So those historical and those historical reflections are also seen in the architecture, on the architectural front as well. Then finally, we have Renaissance art in context of world architecture. Renaissance art, as we know, Renaissance was a form of revival and rebirth of the classical Greek and Roman traditions. So in this context as well, in the context of architecture as well, with the coming of Renaissance architecture, there was an attempt at reviving and reconstructing the styles of architecture that had developed in the time of Greeks and Romans, that is in the times of ancient traditions of building activity. So this is a brief, a very brief outline of what the world architecture was at the time of what the world architecture was throughout history, and we will be referring to some of these elements briefly in context of our study of Indian architecture and the influences of world architecture on Indian architecture throughout the course of history. Before going into that, we'll just take one brief moment to look at Ferguson's classification of architecture. We have come across Ferguson when we talked about the classification of styles of architecture. We talked about Cunningham and Ferguson because these are the earliest scholars who have worked on the history of architecture. And according to Ferguson, the classification of world architecture can be done on two categories or two criteria. One is topographical and the other is on the basis of chronology. In the chronological context, he divides the history of architecture in Christian and non-Christian categories, and topographically he divides it into Eastern and Western categories. So this is a brief footnote to whatever we are studying, just to give you a context of how earlier scholars looked at different categories of architecture and how did they classify architecture, right? We are not going to go into the details of Ferguson's classification. We have looked at them briefly when we talked about the classification of architecture done by these earliest scholars. Now, we will come to directly to the issue at hand, that is how various trends of architecture across the world had influences on the Indian architectural scenario or Indian architectural scene. So now we are going to look at the architectural trends in the Indian subcontinent and how various trends of world architecture influence those architectural trends in India, and we are going to start with the Mauryan age. A little background to the Mauryan architectural trends and the development in the Mauryan phase and the influences on the Mauryan architecture would be to look at the movement of Greeks from the from their homelands in the west to the eastern territories. The Alexander's invasion and Alexander's movement towards the eastern territories is well known, and as a result of that movement there was a strong movement of various cultural activities and cultural trends as well from those regions to the Indian subcontinent or to the eastern regions, including the Indian subcontinent. And obviously the architectural elements, the Hellenistic architecture, that means the Greek architecture, was also something that was brought by the Greeks to the eastern territories. And because of that, from 500 BC onwards, we see that at Persia, there was a amalgamation of various architectural trends, including the architectural trends of Egyptian nature, of Hellenistic, that is Greeks, and also of their own original Iranian architectural trends. So there was this amalgamation that was there in Persia, and since the Mauryan Empire shared borders with those regions, and the influences of the architectural trends that were there at that particular point of time also had an effect on the Mauryan art that developed in this time. And for context, the Mauryan art was mostly focused on the development of monuments of Buddhist faith, and obviously especially in the time of Emperor Ashoka, there was this focus on development of Buddhist architectural and Buddhist monumental features, and these trends were there, and there was a strong influence of the Persian tradition on these architectural developments. And it was from these Persian traditions which include the elements of Hellenistic and Egyptian architecture, there was Ashokan borrowing from there. Ashokan and Mauryan architecture borrowed from there, and there was this development of columned halls, for example, or sculptured reliefs, for example, or inscriptions on rocks, which was borrowed by the Mauryan architectural by the Mauryan architects or by the Mauryan buildings from these Persian traditions. And there were some workmen or people or artisans who were trained in Greco-Persian traditions, that is the Greek-Persian traditions. They were also engaged with the Indian craftsmen, and a combination of these architectural and workmanship, architectural trends and workmanship, created the Mauryan art, which had strong Hellenistic influences, that means the Greek influences. Just a little side to this particular discussion, Hellenistic by the term itself means to speak Greek or to identify with the Greeks, right? So that is the major background to the using the term Hellenistic in context of Greek architectural influences or Greek cultural influences on various architectural trends, especially on the Mauryan architecture that developed in the time of Ashok, especially focusing on the Buddhist monumental development. Following the Mauryan Empire, the post-Mauryan time ranging from 250 BC to 450 AD, we have classified it like that. So, in that particular time period, there were a number of architectural influences, because there were a number of political and racial influences and incoming people belonging to different races brought with themselves their own architectural trends, their own cultural traditions. The few main elements or the few main ethnic groups involved in the northern Indian polities at that particular point of time were Greeks. Obviously, we have already talked about the Greeks, and there was an following the decline of the Mauryan Empire, there was again an intrusion from the Greeks in the Indian subcontinent from the northwestern regions. They were the Greeks, the Central Asian elements of Parthians and Scythians, and then there were these already present Indian traditions that were there and Indian craftsmen that were there. So, there was an amalgamation of these particular trends, these particular cultures that generated the post-Mauryan art. This intersection of various groups belonging to various ethnicities and various cultures generated an Indo-Buddhist art which had European influences, which had Central Asian influences, and which had the indigenous influences of the Indian nature as well. What were the major important influences that were there in these regions? Obviously, in this particular time period, the most focus and the most concentration, the major concentration of architectural activity is of Buddhist nature. And in this particular time, there was a focus on development of anthropomorphic models. That is the that's also a very important Greek influence. Anthropomorphic means anything that is related to human form, and Greeks were famous for creation of exquisite and detailed human figures, and an influence of that was seen in the post-Mauryan time as well. There was a development of art which had anthropomorphic nature, and this particular influence was of Hellenistic nature. This time period of post-Mauryan phase had these influences, and as a result of these influences, there was a development of Greco-Buddhist or Greco-Bactrian art. These are the terms or the categories that have been used by various scholars. These have also been put to criticism in various by various other scholars, but for the sake of lack of better terms, we can use these terms like Greco-Buddhist, that means Greek and Buddhist traditions, and Greco-Bactrian traditions. And what was also a very important development was at this particular point of time was that these traditions focused in a region which now we understand as Gandhara, and the Gandhara school of art in the Buddhist art is a very famous school of art, and it was a result of the post-Mauryan influences, including very majorly the influence of Hellenistic nature, which led to the development of the Gandhara school of art at that particular phase, at that particular point of time. Further, we have with the beginning of the Christian era, Christian era, there was still focus on Buddhist art, and it was only in the early medieval period, in the period of the Guptas, that we see that the development of temple architecture had started. Now, a brief background to that would be the various religious and cultural traditions at that particular point of time in the Indian subcontinent. We know that the reign of Buddhism in the Indian subcontinent was far and wide, and it was only with the coming of Shankaracharya in 7th, 8th century that there was this there was a revival of Brahmanism in that sense, and that revival was there. And in that particular time, there was a lot of political turmoil, political trouble going on between the Buddhists and the Brahmanical religious people belonging to Brahmanical religious faith. And it was in the first century AD, first millennium AD, that any other form of art apart from the Buddhist art, which was the prime focus from Mauryan times onwards, that any other form of art was you know, developing. And it was in this early medieval time period of the Guptas that the development of temples had started. In this development of temples, a major influence was of the ancient commentary known as Satapatha Brahmana, which describes how shrine has to be constructed, what it should be composed of. It says that shrine should be composed of two shed formed of posts and beams covered with reeds and mats. So this is a very basic description of what a temple should consist of, basic, very basic bare minimum of it. And it was only in the 7th century AD that only in the second half of the 7th century AD that a temple form as we know it today developed in a proper manner. Why was there no temple in the earlier phase? Because the religion was more focused on ritualistic aspects, on spiritual aspects, and there was no need at that particular point of time to have any earthly depiction of religious figures. And over time, with the development of various traditions, with the development of with the influences of Buddhist architecture, because the creation of the image of Buddha was already there, and it was probably an influence or a borrowing from those Buddhist architectural and artistic trends, that there was a focus or there was an attempt at creating physical form for God in Brahmanical religions as well, And eventually there was this development of temple in the 7th century AD. And it was in the later period of the Guptas. So this is a brief outline of what was the influences, or what were the influences on Indian architecture prior to the coming of Turks, or prior to the coming of arcuate architecture in the Indian subcontinent. Now, with this new phase of Indian architecture, with the coming of Turks, there were various newer elements that were included by these incoming traditions or incoming people, and they had their own influences, they had their own likes and dislikes, and they had their own technological developments that they brought with themselves. So a new cultural phase begins with the coming of Turks following the Battle of Tarayan in the northern Indian plains. And this time period has been classified as medieval, and it includes majorly the coming of arcuate architecture to the Indian subcontinent. There was no arcuate architecture prior to that. There have been contests and there have been criticisms to that. We have talked about Havel's criticism in the earlier lectures. So, but primarily the coming of true arch to the Indian subcontinent and true dome to the Indian subcontinent was a Turkish influence on the Indian architectural trends. And there were two styles from which majorly arcuate style has been divided: the Roman and the Parthian. Right, the Roman we have already talked about in very brief manner, and the Parthian style was the style from which the Iranian style developed. And Iranian style then included the Mongol style, the Timurid style, and the post-Timurid style. So these are the three traditions that have been classified within the Iranian style, which is itself a subdivision of the Parthian style. Okay. Now, what would the Timurid tradition include? Because in India, the tradition has come from the Timurid traditions. The Timurid tradition would include elements of architecture which were there, which were developed in the time of successors of the famous king Timur. His successors include the Muzaffarids at Fars, there were his successors at Isfahan, and in these regions, at Fars and Isfahan, in these Persian regions, there was this development of architecture, and there was also a borrowing from the Persian regions and application of those Persian architectural trends to the regions of Samarkand, Bukhara and Herat in Central Asia. So, there was a major influence of the Persian architectural trends at this particular point of time, the Persian architectural trends of arcuate nature, which were originally a part of the Parthian traditions. So, this is a brief outline of where, how do we retrace the coming of arcuate method to the Indian subcontinent. Now, in the earliest architectural buildings, earliest architectural endeavors of the Delhi Sultans or the Delhi Sultanate, these Iranian architectural features are very much visible. There was in the mosques that were constructed in the early phase of the Sultanate period, there were plans which were similar to the plans followed by Seljuk traditions of architecture were visible, and during the Mughal period the Iranian influence was more evident and more visible and more robust in that sense. There were major elements which were of Iranian borrowing in the Mughal architecture were the Chaharbagh plan, which was the plan on which the gardens were divided into four quartered divisions. There were the Hasht Bahisht plan of building activity, the non-epartite plan or Hasht Bahisht plan, and there was this influence of Mukarnas, which was a series of squinches and intersecting arches in that sense. And these elements, some of pure aesthetic nature, some of utilitarian and aesthetic nature, were borrowed from Iranian traditions, right? Having said that, we do not need to assume that in the Sultanate and the Mughal period the major influences were only of Iranian nature or of Central Asian origin, but there were major indigenous influences as well. In Mughal period, we see very visible influences of traditions of indigenous origins that had developed in Indian subcontinent originally. For example, there was borrowing from Gujarat school of art, there was borrowing from Malwa school of art. So, these schools of arts had major influences, and there was a give and take that was there amongst these traditions. So, this we need to understand between the Gwalior school of art, Gwalior architectural trends. So, this was what we need to understand, and there were also changes in the architectural form by the indigenous influences. For example, there is this the idea of having three domes in mosques has been associated by some scholars to the trinity of Hindu origin, the trinity that is there in the Hindu religion of Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh, and that trinity is symbolically represented according to these scholars in the three domes of any mosque, because three domed mosques are the most common mosques in the Indian subcontinent. So, there are trends which have borrowed from indigenous traditions and which have given to indigenous traditions. So, there is a give and take, but Iranian architecture had a very major influence during the medieval period. Coming to the next phase of the Indian architecture, that is the colonial phase, we will just briefly look at the influences that are there at that particular point of time. We know that the Indian subcontinent had incoming or had the coming of various European companies, including the Portuguese, the Dutch, the French and the English, of which the English were the most successful, but still the Portuguese and the French also left behind strong architectural and in the sense of aesthetics, they left behind their elements. But majorly there was the there was the influence of English architecture or English traditions, because they were the people who ruled India for a long period of time. And in their architecture we see that there was less focus on ornamentation, as we have seen that the medieval traditions and even the ancient and the early medieval traditions had strong aesthetic elements of detailed ornamentation, either on stone or on bricks or on, you know, in the form of paintings at certain point of time. So there was an element of ornamentation that was there in the earlier traditions before the colonial architecture. And in colonial architecture there was not that much focus on ornamentation, but a more focused attention was given on the simplicity and the size, and that size was supposed to, it struck awe in the minds of the viewers. So that was the entire idea behind the colonial architecture. Major elements of colonial architecture which were new to the Indian architectural scenario were the introduction of town halls, the introduction of clock towers, the introduction of huge gateways, and most of them, majorly all the English architectural trends followed Renaissance influences, Renaissance architectural trends. They were because there was Renaissance architecture that was flourishing in Europe at that particular point of time, and they had this Renaissance architecture carried to the Indian subcontinent, and all these colonial architectural elements had the elements of Renaissance architecture in them. This along with, again, there was not any at any particular point of time in any tradition, there was not unidirectional flow. There was again a dialogue, a multi-dimensional approach, and there was a number of multiple influences which led to the creation of a particular architecture or a particular trend. For example, in Europe, in the European influences of colonial period, there were still elements of Indian traditions that were already there. For example, the Mughal Indian traditions were there, and they combined themselves with the European traditions and created something different and something new. And these amalgamation or these coming together of two traditions of indigenous origin and of colonial borrowing from Europe led to the creation of Indo-European architecture, which are reflected in cities like Jaipur, in cities like Lucknow, so these in cities like Calcutta especially. So these borrowings and these influences and these amalgamation was major part of architecture of the Indian subcontinent, and throughout history there have been influences of the foreign traditions of architecture on the Indian architectural traditions, and there were also an indigenization of those traditions that was there. The amalgamation of various traditions was there, and it needs to be understood that at any particular point of time, any cultural influence is not unidirectional, and there was a dialogue between various cultures, and as a result of that there are certain architectural trends that emerged that are the defining features of the Indian subcontinent. Thank you.